All right, well, we'll go ahead and get started as it appears to be about the appointed hour. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the final panel discussion of the day, Sealift. Special thanks to LMI for sponsoring this very important topic. Thank you, shipmate. My name is Buzby. I'm the happen to be the president of the National Defense Transportation Association, former commander of Military Sealift Command, and in general, lover of ships and sailors who sail them. We have assembled here this afternoon the principal government stakeholders who figure prominently in the Sealift equation. And as you can see, it's not just a Navy thing. There are a lot of moving parts across the joint force and a significant role played by commercial industry in our Sealift capacity, and that's just on a normal day. Add in the budget challenges faced by the government, the economic challenges faced by commercial ship operators, and the growing potential that the next large Sealift operation will take place in a contested environment, not just the benign environment we saw during Desert Shield, Desert Storm. Well, now you're talking about an issue that gets to the top of the pile of a lot of people's desks. Our mission today is to help you understand that we need to have a fundamentally different discussion about Sealift than we've maybe had in the last 10 years or so. It's probably one of the least understood parts of the defense transportation system, but it is the key enabler to moving our nation's combat power forward and then sustaining it. We have a lot to think about and a lot to discuss, but we have the right folks here to do just that. We'll hear about the requirements, we'll hear about the assets, and we'll hear about future plans. And then we're going to want to hear about you, about our panelists after they conclude their presentations. Now, you'll note that we are one panelist short up here. General McDew was to be here today and literally just moments ago got called away for a matter of state that was obviously pretty important because I know he wanted to be here and wanted very much to talk about Sealift. He is very passionate about it. Those of you that were at the luncheon today heard him discuss it. He has made it his number one priority. Which is pretty amazing for a transcom commander. As far as I know, it's the first time that's ever occurred. So he gets Sealift and is very sorry that he could not be here and sends his apologies. However, we do have somebody who can fill in and speak to the area that he was going to speak to, which was primarily the Sealift requirement. And that is a panelist that was going to be here anyway, and he's now going to be doing double duty. And that is one Mr. Scott DiLisio, who heads up the Strategic Mobility and Combat Logistics Division, better known as OPNAV N42. Mr. DiLisio was appointed to the Senior Executive Service in December of 2006 and has 25 years of federal service. He's responsible for providing Sealift and combat logistics planning, programming, and policy guidance to the Deputy Chief of Naval Operations, Fleet Readiness and Logistics, N4, to the Deputy Assistant Secretary of the Navy, RDA, ships, and to the Director for Logistics, Joint Chiefs of Staff, for a fleet of over 100 ships. For those of you who may not have a good sight picture about what Scott does, just think of him as the young John Caskin. There's the old John Caskin for comparison's sake. As a platform sponsor, N42 is responsible for planning and setting policy for our Navy's strategic Sealift and combat logistic forces for the next 30 to 50 years. They also provide subject matter experts for all Sealift and mobility issues studies that go on throughout the Navy. So with that, please join me in welcoming Mr. Scott DiLisio.
That was bad. By the way, I've never ever called you the old John Caskin. Matter of fact, there's a lot of things that you told me that I am living the dream right now. So can you guys hear me okay?
Pull a little closer, maybe.
So if General McDew were here, he would tell you we need more Sealift. He would also tell you that we need new Sealift. He and I suffer a very same fate, and it's going to be very difficult for me to do his part and my part because that makes me a little schizophrenic, because as you know, resourcing is not always making the COCOM happy. but we have definitely forged a partnership. Transcom is able to play at a level of detail that they find painful, but they enjoy. And my partners here are going to talk to you about the results of what we're able to do together. So General McDew wants to move as much of the force as he can whenever he needs to. Very simple requirement, sounds like it, except the force is massive and our force is not necessarily big enough to move it all in one shot. Then you add a few other neat features like getting shot at, cyber attacks, ways of the world that most of you see in your everyday life. Somebody hacks your account. Just imagine if your account was an engineering plant on a ship. So very important things going on. The general's question is, what are you doing to mitigate the risk? So let me start with resourcing variables. And I closed my notes because it's going to be tough to be General McDew with my notes. Age of a vessel is a variable, and our force is getting fairly old. The type of vessel is a variable. We don't have all the same type. So when you see warships, you know, we try to get close to the same type as much as we can. We don't have that luxury when it comes to auxiliaries and sealift ships. We have some, but for the most part, we have a lot of configuration proliferation. We have parts needs that are different on almost every ship because of age, because of wear and emergent capability that we have. We have ships all over the world. We have them all over the United States, all over the world, which means different capabilities for repair, and yet they all have to be ready, they all have to locate, they all have to load, and in the case of the auxiliaries, they're on the pointy end, they have to win in order to bring the heavy load in for Sealift. So you get Sealift ships are around 60 plus ships in my portfolio. I've got over 160 ships total, and that is not my phone. So back to General McDew. I want to move it. I want to move it as fast as I can. I want to go heavy, and I want to take as much as I can. Over to you, resource sponsor. What are you going to do? Well, if you went to the last panel, I thought one of the speakers had an interesting comment. He said, we're in an age where we manage what's left. And it just so happens that right now, I have to keep everything we have pinpoint ready because it is what we have left. It's a large force, and somebody's going to ask me, well, then it's time to recapitalize, isn't it? Yes, it is. And so with the general, he probably outed me at lunch, but with the general, we are starting to work a comprehensive plan to figure out how to rebuild Sealift. And so some of you have a vision of what that might be, because you have maybe some knowledge of what a Sealift ship looks like. What we're going to build is the Sealift ship for 30 years from now, not today's Sealift ship. So it has capabilities and it has, let's just call it, quirks about it that you don't see today that make it more capable for the 30 years we have to go forward. So now let's get back to resourcing. The force we have is required. I can't let it go, and it has to be ready. So age of the ship, the type of ship, and those things that we need to do to keep that ship ready, and I'm sure you folks will talk about that a little bit, about how hard it is to do on a constrained budget. But the budget is constrained over 160 ships, not just 60. And the 160 ships is constrained because it competes with every warship on the planet. And so the question now is, how do we build a comprehensive program to rebuild Sealift? And that's what the partners and I, with General McDew's influence, are going to have to do over the next year. We're going to have to put our program on the table. And over the next year, we'll have to figure out how to get resourced. So now what's the important piece? Keeping the current force ready to go. We have a budget in place right now that does that. You'll see a little bit of an increase in the budget for current Sealift vessels and auxiliaries for that matter. So we're starting to make sure that material condition doesn't drive us to a ship that we cannot activate. These folks on either side of me will get a chance to activate more often to prove that their ships actually are ready to go, because we are entering into a sense of urgency that's a little higher than we're used to. So then you say, well, how much do Sealift ships cost? Well, I'm going to walk you through a list of things. And you probably didn't think about this, but Sealift as a resource, everybody thinks ships. So we talked about age of the ship. We now have dry dock results we've got to pay attention to. We have certification partners that are under fire. ABS, Coast Guard, these are our partners that keep our ships certified and safe and ready to go to sea. So if they're pressurized, we're pressurized. It would be a hell of a thing for me not to be able to have a ship sail because the certification agent had been cut to the point of not having us as a priority. Pretty important stuff. Schedules top everything. If the ship needs to be put in a dry dock, then it goes. If it needs to be put out on a mission, the question is which one takes precedence. Right now, the dry dock does. In the future, we may not be so kind to our ships and we may have to go. Cash flow and timing. I could tell you all about resourcing at the Pentagon. All I'd need to do is burst into tears for about 10 solid minutes and you'd pretty much have the picture. Ship support, engineering, talent engineering, spare parts, repair and maintenance capabilities. And I'm talking not just in the office, I'm talking about in the shipyards all over the world. Tooling, test equipment, training. Exercises and activations have to rise because right now our results are not where we want them to be, so we're going to have to exercise more. Does anybody know what the difference between fully operational and reserve means? So fully operational means you're out there every single day, forward deployed. We have ships that run with the strike groups and the ARGs, and they fortify those. Warfighting capabilities, pointy end, no kidding, getting shot at, and we do it with merchant mariners every single day. I have command ships that are hybrid crewed. I have submarine tenders that are hybrid crewed. So that means that not only is the uniformed fighter there, but the hybrid merchant mariner is there as well. Same heat. Then we talk about location. So the mariner wants to know, where am I going? How long am I going to be there? Is there any industrial support where I'm going? Is the water deep enough? Big ships. Can I get everything I need? Do I have to get my parts through customs? I mean, stuff today, that's almost foreign to our DNA if you're fighting a war. You're like, okay, I think I'm going to clear customs pretty easily. Well, maybe not so much if the country you're working with isn't participating. Things are a little strange today, and those things cause resource problems and variables. So General McDew says, hey, that's great, I got it. You're going to have to figure that out. And the next class of ships is going to be needed and needed soon. John, you and I have talked about shipbuilding quick. Got to do it soon. We also got to keep our mariners. Our mariner health is important or we won't have anybody to man the ships when we build them. So if you got a chance to listen to the last panel, there's some pretty dire pieces of information in there that you should pay attention to. If you didn't get to go, you ought to go back and look at the slides, because we continue to admire the problem. We haven't solved it. And so now it's time to solve the problem where we won't have a Sealift capability because the mariners won't come. Anybody worried about port costs, canal passage? Well, that's kind of sporty when you have a really big ship full of a warfighting machine. We got to pay attention to it. Worldwide concerns, no warning activations, and the task to bring the fight. I don't think everybody realizes Sealift brings the fight heavy. So the resource that I'm talking to you about today, and I've spent almost no time on it in the almost 5 years I've been in the seat, is that these are not even ships I'm talking about. I'm talking about the people of the Maritime Administration, and I'm talking about the people of Military Sealift Command, and then I'm talking about the user community that I think Nancy's going to help us with a little bit. Those are the resources that I'm trying to keep alive. And if we don't keep them alive, I don't have ships anymore. So I think General McDew would tell you, by the way, if I'm sitting in for him, I understand I was great at lunch. But he's a good friend. He's very concerned. He's an avid supporter of this, and I know because he spends a lot of time yelling at me to get the resources protected and up so that we can do our job. And I know if I need the help, he'll come and give it to me and the folks around me. And Buzz, I think I'll hold it at that.
All right, thank you, Scott. Appreciate the remarks and some hope there, hopefully, for the future of our Merchant Marine and recapitalizing. We'll perhaps hear a little bit more about that later. Our next panelist is General McDew's Maritime Component Commander. He also happens to be the Navy Commander of Military Sealift Command. He owns assets. He's going to talk about those things that Scott was just talking about. Rear Admiral Dee Mewbourne is a 1982 Naval Academy graduate and has commanded an air squadron, three aircraft carriers, an amphibious ship, two carrier strike groups, and a Naval Service Training Command. He knows a little bit about ships, even as for an aviator. He took command of MSC in August of 2016. Please join me in welcoming Rear Admiral Dee Mewbourne.
Thanks, Buzz, and thank you all. You know, I came with a thesis, that is that Sealift is integral to national security. And I would start, sort of developing that thesis by taking us back to World War II and a battle that we call now the Battle of the Atlantic. Not really, you know, a battle in the classic sense, and that it wasn't fought over a single place in a single period, in days or weeks, but really measured in years, you know, from 1939 to 1945, and spanned the entire Atlantic Ocean, and it was really, a battle against our wills, I would say, our will to move supplies and goods in order to reinforce the war in Europe, and of course the Nazi will to prevent that, and we kind of know the outcome of it. I think that Winston Churchill, he observed in his memoir that the Battle of the Atlantic was the dominating factor all through the war. So we started with about 1,340 ships is what the stats are that I looked up. And when the war ended, we had a merchant fleet that was these impressions that he left me now as I walk the Norfolk waterfront are very powerful, and especially in the job that I'm in now. As I think about that same Atlantic Ocean and what the future may hold for the mariners, right, the very mariners that work for MSC, I guess it gives me a sense of duty and obligation that that is quite honed by his service. I also, as was mentioned, I've had the opportunity to command three aircraft carriers, one of which was the Dwight D. Eisenhower. And in that tour, I learned this quote from Ike that I thought was something, again, that is it means a lot to me. He said that history does not long entrust the care of the freedom to the weak or the timid. You've heard the quote, I'm sure. And again, it's something that resonates. And that you also have heard that if you seek peace, prepare for war. And so I carry those two things in the images of my dad with me as I've come into the job here at MSC. And putting it all together then, the obligation to protect the mariners of the future if there is a Battle of the Atlantic too. And making sure that if we do seek peace, that we're preparing for war. And that history does not entrust the care of freedom to people who are weak or timid. And that is that I can't afford to be weak or timid, right? Because I do feel like that it's my time, at least in sharing with all of you in this room, and we're entrusted with the care of freedom. MSC is a fantastic organization. It has a global mission. We empower global warfighting capability. We support the joint warfighter anywhere in the world across the full spectrum of operations We provide assured on-time logistics, 24/7, 365. And I think that the mission of MSC is represented, at least in me, to me, by this image that's over on the left-hand side. It's an image that I created when I first got to MSC. I'm a very visual learner, and so for me to have an image that kind of represents a lot of elements is something that that I find kind of powerful. So we created something that that would help me tell the story of what I saw as my vision for MSC during my tenure. If you would allow me just to kind of describe this picture as I see it metaphorically. You know, the picture, first of all, I would say it is a picture, not a painting, of one of our Sealift ships as she was, I think it was taken maybe even from a ship of one of our coalition partners, I'm told. But the ship is, what it represents to me is obviously a ship that's, you know, mighty, it's in great shape, you know, and it sort of represents, you know, readiness and the need to preserve that readiness, that wholeness. And also, I know you can't see them, but if you could zoom in, you would see all these mariners, right? Men and women of conviction who have given some portion of their life to the service of their country and something that they believe is greater than them, some calling. And those young mariners, those mariners old and young, are out there, you know, doing what we ask them to do very professionally, right? Assured logistics anywhere in the world. And then the other thing it represents to me is you can see the seas are roiling. So obviously there is something about the system that they're in, that there is a challenge, you know, to the seas that ship is in right now. And what I would ask you to do is if you can, imagine with me that you could, you know, zoom out a little bit. And my question to you, you know, given the state of the world, and that this is sort of a metaphorical representation of MSC, mm-hmm. Where is the storm? And to me, the storm is actually to the right-hand side, off the bow of the ship, that the ship is sailing into the storm, and that's represented sort of by representing the challenges that the ship or that MSC faces, the industry faces today. The first of which I think is mentioned a lot. It was mentioned by General McDew and Scott just now, and even Buzz in the opening, and that is that, you know, we are sailing in contested waters. The debate whether we will ever sail in contested waters again or something is, I think, over. With if nothing more than what happened with the Swift and the Strait of Bab el-Mandeb, and the fact today, you know, that we have put out advisories to the mariners that are sailing those waters. And then, of course, you know, there's things that we're still seeing piracy off Somalia. You've seen that, and then you have the rise of near peers or peers in the Pacific, or Putinism, or expansionism. The resurgence in Russia, as well as the challenges that we're seeing in cyberspace. And then on top of that, we add challenges. You know, whether it's the budget or the health of our mariner force, the world economy, and the list goes on. And the seas in which that we operate, I think, then, are getting more contested, or they're more challenged than ever before. I produced a strategy when I got to MSC. It was called the Voyage Plan. And it's, as its name implies, it is a top-level document about where we are and where we're going. I invite you can Google it or whatever. You can find it online or on our website. And it basically describes what I think where MSC is going over my tenure. And in there, I put, I listed what I call the four pillars, those tenets or those elements on which the entire organization, I think, rests each and every day. It's our people, our platforms, our processes, and partners. And I think that the first three are pretty self-explanatory, that we couldn't do what we do without them. It's the fourth P, the partners. It's why I'm here today. I'm here because of you, the partners that we have, whether you represent, you know, the shipbuilding industry or repair, maritime unions, operating companies, the maritime schools, laboratories, analysts, think tanks, advocacy groups, federal, state, local government agencies, all of you partner with MSC to ensure that we can do what it is trying to, that we do around the world with assured maritime logistics. So I need your help. We need your help in solving these complex challenges that face MSC. For example, if you represent maritime unions, the question might be, how do you train mariners to be ready to operate in a contested environment? If you're a shipbuilder, maybe how do you build a platform that's ready to last for 30 years and survive in combat? If you're a ship repair industry, you know, how can you improve your ability to get ships out of your yard on time, right? Because we are getting more and more demand. If you're in industry, what innovation can you that will come from you to help MSC meet its global mission? If you're in the military, the question might be, how do you incorporate seaborne logistics into planning and experimentation, right, and wargaming with realistic maritime logistic factors such as attrition? How do we harden our cyber interfaces, especially with industry? And how do we do this great collaboration and information sharing while still keeping operation security at the forefront? The bottom line is that there's a lot of questions for all of us. And I tell you what, if you've got ideas, I have time to listen. The motto at the bottom is United We Sail. And I created that because I think that it had a couple of, you know, it's short and sweet and I can remember it. But it has elements in it that matter a lot to me. My tenure really is all about unification, unity of focus and unity of effort. And acting, I believe that if we act as one with a clear and a shared vision of our in-state and perform as a championship team, we will not fail. Ready, relevant, and resolute. United, we sail. United includes you. Thank you. I look forward to your questions. And I have a team here from MSC. If there's really hard ones, I'll have to phone a friend. But thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Admiral. Our next panelist is the other government Sealift owner. Mr. Kevin Tokarski is the U.S. Maritime Administration Associate Administrator for Strategic Sealift. He is a 1984 graduate of Fort Schuyler, holds a U.S. Coast Guard license, and was selected to serve in the Senior Executive Service in 2008. As Associate Administrator, his responsibilities include government-owned capabilities in the Ready Reserve Force and the National Defense Reserve Fleet, cargo and commercial sealift capabilities in the Maritime Security Program, and through cargo preference programs. He also deals in emergency preparedness and response, ship disposal, and supporting the nation's 7 maritime academies and workforce development. He supports civil military planning for the North Atlantic Treaty Organization as chairman of the Transport Group for Ocean Shipping. Please join me in welcoming Mr. Kevin Tokarski.
Thanks. Thank you very much, and thank all of the audience here for participating and sitting in on this late on a Tuesday afternoon. I think we're standing between you and a reception, but I really do appreciate this is a bit of a homecoming, I think, for us in the Sealift community to have you here with us. As Admiral Buzby mentioned, my role in the Maritime Administration in the Department of Transportation, about 75% of our work is really to make sure that we've got a sealift capability to be able to support the nation. And so when I say that, I mean federal ships as part of that portfolio, the commercial industry, and maritime education and training to include support to 7 maritime academies as well as our industry training schools with that. You know, I thought I was going to have General McDew here, and I was going to kind of be sitting between a guy who's got a resource requirement or resource control, if you will, as well as a guy who has a requirement that's pretty high. And that's oftentimes the balance that we're having in the Sealift portfolio. The changes in the evolving nature of our business because we'll never have everything that we need, whether it's funding or the modern ships and the capabilities that we have. So we strive with the resources that we have, which includes the people and the ships, to be able to maintain that nation's portfolio. So I was thinking this is 2017. It's been 40 years, actually, when the nation decided that we needed to have a surge sealift capability. And so it was the Department of the Navy. There was no Transcom then. It was the Department of the Navy and the Maritime Administration that came together and said, we need to take some ships that are coming out of the commercial industry that no longer have the kind of capabilities that they saw a decline in the commercial flag fleet, and to be able to set those aside and park them in our reserve fleets, and we're going to maintain them in a higher state of readiness. We're going to maintain them where we never activate them. We don't have any crews on board, but yet we'll have them in five-day readiness. So we got tested in Desert Shield and Desert Storm. We did okay, not as good as we wanted, but we drastically, and I'll say revolutionized what we did with Sealift from Desert Shield and Desert Storm. So if that's what you think of and what you remember from Sealift, that's not what it is today. It's dramatically different in terms of the investment that we've done and how we maintain that portfolio. But it's interesting when you go back and you go back a little bit farther in history in the Spanish-American War, and what happened then? We didn't have a Sealift industry to be able to call from, and we struggled with being able to support our forces deployed overseas. So Congress said we need to change that a little bit, and so they actually, when they started the implementation of moving government cargo on commercial vessels to try to retain a capability within the commercial fleet. So when I look at Sealift, you can tell by my dialect, I'm looking at commercial and federal that have to work together, and we've got to support both together. So I've got a role in DOT that works on supporting that, and that does include trying to sustain the fleet both with cargo and as well as with direct stipend payments for that. So the RRF's been around for 40 years, and my colleagues and I are working to extend it so that we've got ships in our fleet that are going to be around for about 55 to 60 years. And while the vessels generally, we've acquired them, and the model was that we acquired ships that were used but good. They had still some unique capabilities with them. We invested a little bit in them. But the big thing that we did and that we changed after the first Gulf War is we put mariners on board those ships, mostly engineers. And on the decky, I recognize that we're kind of in a maintenance mode for these Sealift assets. And that really is, that's the readiness enabler, is those individuals that are part of our crew on board those ships today. Now, I got a challenge with them, too, because they cost money. And my cost in the balance of the program is how we right-size the right positions on board the ship to maintain that within the resources that we have to be able to pay for dry dockings. And as we're seeing, our costs are going up significantly in the industrial base just to maintain these assets with that capability. Let's go to the next slide, please. So as I mentioned, we look at the ships that are in the U.S. flag trade and the industrial, our U.S. flag base, the 81 ships that are in international trade. If you were in the last panel, I'm not going to repeat all that, but 97 ships also, large ships that are in the Jones Act trade. And why do we count those ships? Particularly, we count them because we're looking at the mariner base that we're going to draw from when we activate these ships. When I need 1,900 mariners in 4 days, I've got to find people on the beach. And that beach comprises of those mariners that are in vacation relief, that are coming off of sailing on those roughly 200 ships, large vessels, meaning they're holding the credentials to be able to meet our baseline needs. You heard General McDew talk about that at lunch today. We are on the edge. We are on the edge of having enough mariners for that. So tied to that, one of the programs that we do is in supporting the maritime security program. So I support 60 ships in international trade to sail under that flag. Now there's about 11 others that do it too, because they're able to find some cargo and to continue working. But that size has continued to decrease, and we lost 20% of that fleet, U.S. flag fleet, just in the last 5 years alone. So we're working on strengthening the MSP. We want, and we've asked Congress for full appropriation to the full authorized level of the MSP program. But I know we had to talk with General McDew and our leadership in the agency. I'm really focused on what's MSP 4.0 going to be. The program that we've been doing for, in essence, the last 30 years, I'm not sure that's going to meet the needs going forward into the future. I'm not sure it's going to be as flexible to the desires of Transcom for the types of ships and the ability to be able to adapt that fleet on short notice. So we're already thinking ahead of 2025, because it's going to take us that much time to be able to figure out what is the next solution for retaining our U.S. flag commercial fleet so that it's available to be able to meet DOD's needs. And then I'm also going to be able to have it sized large enough so that I can get enough mariners for the fleet for that. I think that on this slide, I would ask you a question on that. Do you think that matters? Do you think that matters as a maritime nation that when we sit in the international realm, we're representing 81 ships in the international community against the 50,000 flag vessels that are out there? I think it matters. Not only you get to see power in that, but I also tell you, I think it matters from a sense of having a low-cost flag presence where we don't have to send a gray hull. And if we had more flag ships that were flying and moving in the South China Sea and having a greater presence, that's American presence in those areas where we don't have to send Navy gray hull ships to be able to exercise freedom of navigation. I think it matters quite a bit for economic security, international security, and as well as our national security. Next slide. So we talked about looking at our mariners and where they come from in our commercial fleet. I'll tell you, we're on yellow on a stoplight chart, flashing into red zone right now, with the available pool. We're looking at how we're going to be able to meet our mariner requirements. We're broadening our aperture. We're looking at the strategic sealift officers. So this is a pool of graduates from our maritime academies that have a service obligation. Most of them stay current with their license for about 8 years, and then they get out of the reserve program. But it is a pool. It's a pool mostly of entry-level officers, but there are some in there. And a fair number of them are already counted in our pool of the actively sailing mariners. But we want to look at that and see how we can make sure that we can tailor that, and we tailor them for the sealift community. If you can move to the next slide. There you go. Thank you. It fits with the visual on talking about mariners. And no, that is not General McDew in Merchant Marine khakis. It's actually my friend Fred Wally, who's one of our merchant ship captains up on the Cape W's in Baltimore. He's been with our program for probably about as long as I have. There's been a number of activations in that with us. He's a good role model for someone who comes from West Africa, who came via the UK into the US and the US Merchant Marine. And I understand he's going to be our newest ensign in the Strategic Sealift Officer Program. He knew some friends, a former administrator of ours, which is kind of neat. So we don't have enough. We're looking at what other options we have available to us. So we activate steamships. I've got 23 steamships in the RF program. I have more. I have twice as many steamships as there are in the commercial fleet. Where am I getting the mariners and the proficiency? So we're looking at things like taking engineers and doubling up when we do have a steamship activation, because I need to work on the proficiency of some of those first assistants and those second assistants so that they can get more steam time to be able to upgrade and retain that proficiency. It's a small investment. It's a small investment that we need to do on our soft tissue, if you will. We're also looking at how we can work on the training, working with the maritime labor unions. We visited with them to see if there may be some things that we can use from a shoreside simulator training base to be able to try to increase some proficiency to actually tie directly back to our sealift capable vessels. And I'd be remiss if I didn't mention, when we talk about training, that we are looking at how we're going to recapitalize our school ship training fleet. The Empire State at SUNY Maritime College is 54 years old. The Kennedy from Mass Maritime's turning 50. And that's how we're training the world's finest merchant marine officers are on ships that are 50 plus years old. I think that needs to change a little bit too. We've been trying to work with the Congress. We've got great congressional support by Cameron, both sides of the aisle. I just don't have support near that place near the White House. I forget what that name is. But we're working on that. We're trying to get the attention to it because it matters that we've got the base and that we're making the future investment for our mariners. And it's not lost on me that if you looked at payscale.com recently, the rankings in that came out from the 2,000 universities and colleges in the country, a couple of the maritime schools were right up there on the top, above Harvey Mudd, above the Ivy League schools in terms of earning potential. So the nation likes these graduates, rewards them with very well-paying careers, and that it's a smart investment, I think, for the future. I'm going to finish on one final historical note. Last week was the 75th anniversary of the sinking of an American vessel called the City of New York. And his ship was sunk in March of 1942, so we weren't in yet. But it sank, Merchant Marine crew on board that ship. There was a doctor who was one of the crew members, Dr. Conley, and he was injured pretty bad getting into the lifeboat, had a couple broken ribs and that, but he was able to tend to a number of the injured crew. They lost about 20 crew members were killed on the vessel, had passengers. He delivers a baby in a lifeboat, and it became a story of that. Well, he passed away in the 1950s, but at the American Merchant Marine Veterans Association in Reno last week, we presented to his son and his grandson the Meritorious Service Medal, which is the highest medal for the U.S. Merchant Marine. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Kevin. Our final panelist here this afternoon is Ms. Nancy Harned, Executive Director of the Naval Expeditionary Combat Command. Ms. Harned entered government service in 1985 and was promoted to senior executive service in May 2007. In her current role, she oversees a portion of NECC called the Naval Expeditionary Logistics Support Group. NAV ELSG is a vital enabler of maritime prepositioning forces and joint logistics over the shore operations. They support maritime forces ashore, providing expeditionary cargo handling services for surface, air, and terminal operations, tactical fueling, ordnance handling and reporting in support of worldwide naval, joint interagency, and combined forces. Please join me in welcoming Ms. Nancy Harned.
Well, good afternoon, everybody. I'm very honored to have this opportunity to talk to you and tell you a little bit about NECC and our forces and how we support the Sealift mission and how we are also a consumer of Sealift, because that's an important piece of how we operate. So NECC, the Navy Expeditionary Combat Command, is a type command. Our mission is to organize, man, train, and equip the Navy's expeditionary combat forces. Which includes the Expeditionary Logistics Support Group that Buzz referred to. We also have the EOD folks. We have the Navy's Construction Forces, the Seabees. We have the Coastal Riverine Forces. We also have a few smaller things, such as the Navy Expeditionary Intelligence Command and the Expeditionary Combat Readiness Center. The forces themselves have been around for a long, long time. The Seabees just celebrated their 75th anniversary. There's an article about them in today's show daily if you're looking for some good reading. The type command, NECC, has only been around since 2006, though. So part of our mission at NECC, as I said, is to organize, man, train, equip, to bring commonality as much as we can to these forces, which are very different. But the forces themselves, they really have a unique niche in many Navy operations, including the Sealift operation. The Navy's expeditionary combat forces that I mentioned, they can operate and sustain themselves. They can protect themselves in austere and challenging environments. They can provide for their own security. They can also provide security to others, which really is part of their mission. They create the expeditionary infrastructure that are required by naval forces to conduct and sustain operations. So as far as the Sealift mission goes, NECC's role in helping the Sealift mission is really that part where you're trying to get the stuff off the ship so it can be at a place where it can safely and reliably sustain those who are ashore and sustain what needs to happen from the shore and back out to sea. So the chart that I have up there on the screen is a picture that shows the Navy support element whose job it is to support the maritime pre-positioning offload and follow-on sustainment operations. And the reason I've depicted it in blue and green is to kind of explain that all those forces don't belong to NECC, only the ones that I am showing in green. We report to the commander of the Navy support element, who is part of the Navy surface forces, SURFLANT or SURFPAC, as their administrative control. But the other blue pieces there on the chart, you have the beachmaster units, the amphibious construction battalions, and the assault craft units. All three of those belong to the surface forces as well. When NECC participates in this mission, we participate with those units. So it's the Navy Naval Cargo Handling Battalions and our Coastal Riverine Force, whose job it is to provide the seaward defense of the operation and possibly the port that we might be going into. The Navy Cargo Handling Battalions, their job it is to unload and unpack ships, to build the logistics points ashore. They also build and operate fuel sites ashore. They also have a mission to protect airports and to do aircraft unloading, but that's not quite what our topic is today. So if we go on to the next slide, I'll talk a little bit about what the rest of the NECC forces and how they support the rest of the mission as well. So NECC's Sealift roles from our other units include the operations where we are helping to set the conditions for the offload, where we're helping in the actual offload, and then beyond the offload. So you see the pieces of our forces that I mentioned a little bit earlier. Our EOD guys, they help when there needs to be water space clearance. So underneath the EOD units, we have our mobile diving and salvage units. So the EOD forces clear areas of explosives, obviously, and render safe any explosives that they might find. The mudsu guys, as we call them, they might be responsible for clearing obstacles and things. So the underwater construction teams, who you see with a dotted line up to the Seabees, their job, both they have a job in setting conditions where installations might need repairing, port repair, that kind of thing. They also have a role in the actual offload when the on the amphibious side, setting up the amphibious bulk liquid transfer system, the mudsu guys would help repair and sustain those. So I already mentioned the units that support in the actual offload, the Expeditionary Logistics Support Group, the Coastal Riverine Forces. And then beyond the offload, the Seabees would help improve the seaports and the airport throughput. So all of NECC's forces play roles here and there in the Sealift mission. But as has been discussed many times, all of this was sort of designed with a permissive environment in mind. That's not to say, when I mentioned the EOD folks would be clearing mines and obstacles, obviously that's somewhat of a contested environment, but probably not in an operation where they're actually being in a live fire kind of situation. So the Navy's thinking hard about this mission. How are we going to operate in the contested environment, not just out on the open ocean, but as we need to bring materials into shore? So at NECC, we are working hard with the rest of the Navy and the Marine Corps in concepts like the distributed maritime operations, littoral operations in a contested environment, and the Marine Corps' expeditionary advanced bases, where the idea is to disperse as much as possible, not to provide fixed locations as much as we can that become targets, as the Marine Corps says, to get off the X. So NECC's forces can play a role in that. The riverine forces with our Mark VI patrol boats, that is one of our newest capabilities. It's an armored boat, not very big, it's only 80 foot, but that's big for our riverine forces. So they can provide much more of a force protection role in that kind of a mission. The challenge there will be that we only have 12 of them. So that's can't spread 12 boats very far. And that's a similar challenge that we have with the rest of our forces. We only have 7 cargo handling battalions, 6 of which are in the reserve force. So we have additional challenges with activating our reserves, getting them to where they need to be. But we have the capabilities, and we're working hard with the rest of the Navy and with the Marine Corps in developing these concepts and being realistic about when and where we can be where we need to be. I said at the beginning that we're also a consumer of Sealift, so I'll just talk a little bit about that. NEC's forces, by and large, can't get to where they need to go by themselves. We need Sealift, we also need airlift. The heaviest pieces of our forces are our cargo handling battalions and also the CB equipment. The CBs have 2 sets of equipment to support 2 battalions that are on our MIPSRON ships, so that equipment is forward that the personnel can fall in on. However, the rest of the CBs who are either most of them stateside, a few forward deployed, they will need strategic Sealift to get the rest of their equipment to where they are. They'll also need intra-theater Sealift to move the equipment around. Our Coastal Riverine Forces, as I said, we have the new capability in our Mark VI patrol boat, but that boat is intended for 24-hour operations, so it will need intra-theater Sealift to get those boats to where they need to be. The rest of our forces are somewhat lighter weight, the EOD folks, the underwater construction teams, the rest of the Coastal Riverine Forces boats and their equipment. So they can either use airlift or Sealift. However, if we know that in the airlift situation that there's just as much of a limited resource problem there as well. So, so we're looking hard at the airlift and Sealift needs as well. So, with that, I will close. Just to remind you, NECC is a very capable force. We do play a key role in the Sealift, but we also really rely on Sealift to get us to where we need to be. Thank you.
Thank you. All right, thank you, panel. And it's now time for a counter battery. So open it up to the audience for any questions you might have for any of our panel.
Thank you all for what you do. I know that funding is never easy, especially in forces that don't get a lot of the daylight in the media. So my question is pertaining to what Ms. Harned talked about, distributed lethality. It's been a concept that Surface Navy Association has been talking about, Admiral Roden's been talking about for a few years. Well, that obviously requires distributed logistics. And on top of all of the things that Mr. DiLisio has already explained are the challenges, how much bigger a load is that to achieve the distributed logistics that are needed to make distributed lethality into a real thing? From the MSC standpoint, from the requirement standpoint, is there a role you're hoping that MARAD plays? Where is that on your list of things that haven't been funded properly?
I know everybody's looking at me. So here's what I would tell you, and I think based on the other suit I used to catch you in, you know this, but we study the demand signal for combat logistics that Admiral Mewbourne's folks provide to whatever the sizing of the fleet is, and that includes the introduction of new ships, whether that be a large ship, new destroyer, whether that be a small ship, LCS. But these folks also participate in the CONOPS and the TTP development, or the tactics. And so since you can't always take a ship and modernize it instantly to do what you need to do against a threat, sometimes what you can do is you can change the behavior on how we operate those ships. I'll be honest with you, if you think I'm going to give you those here, I'm not. But I will tell you, if you think we're going to operate like we're used to, I would tell you, think again, we're a lot smarter than that. I think you'd be really proud of your Navy if you saw some of the things we were doing today. And I'll leave it there.
Great. Yes, ma'am.
Good afternoon. My name's Jessica Glassy, and I, too, went to SUNY Maritime, so shout out, yes. A couple points. The first one, you talk a lot about labor. Okay, I sailed on my license for a very short time as an engineer. I did go through the unions, but I had some questions. So here's some solutions, right? Here's some ideas for you all. One, make it easier for folks like me to keep my Merchant Marine's license. Make it easier. If I want to go shoreside and work a power plant job because they pay better and I can stay home and have kids, make it easier for me to keep my Merchant Marine license if you want me to go back to sea. Make it easier for the Merchant Marine officers who are doing reserve time. I have a lot of classmates. I'm in my 40s. A lot of them let their license go because of all the hoops to jump through to keep their licenses current. Make it easier. You will have a bigger pool. You'll have a bigger pool of those of us in the Gen X range. Make the training easier for them to upgrade or keep their quals. Make it easier for folks coming out of the Coast Guard or Navy to come into the Merchant Marine. They have the skills. Make it easier. Maybe work with those of us here in industry. A lot of my classmates also go into the power plant industry. Mm-hmm. Maybe work with them on some of their training programs, their sims, and stuff like that, and you would be able to help keep the workforce with the right quals and right training. Again, this is Jessica's own opinion, right? This is from me, being in the maritime industry for 20 years and job hopping and doing different things. Second, I work for Kelowna Shipyard, so I do ship repair. Make it easier for us to figure out what you want repaired. We know you want to come out on time, but sometimes you have such a huge laundry list, it's impossible. We need to be able to have a better and open communications during the bidding process. And lots of times, you all don't want that because you want the lowest price possible. The lowest price possible is not going to get you the best product, and it's not going to get your ship out on time. Be realistic about what you want fixed. Prioritize. And those of us here in the ship repair world will work with you. We have folks who are experts at fixing ships. If you could invite some of us to help you with these lists and prioritizations, we would gladly help you. Again, 2 cents just from the peanut gallery. Thank you for being here. Thank you for opening it up. Oh, and pay, MSC. Again, I have a lot of classmates. We all like to talk and tell sea stories. MSC, you're not known for your pay scale, especially with the other merchant mariners on other ships, even the foreign-classed vessels or the ships here are still flagged in our fleet. And you're not known to have nice time schedules. You need to let those folks set a time, 6 months, 9 months, 12 months. You extend a lot of the times that folks are away from their families. You need to make sure that if you tell them they're going to be able to get home, they're going to be able to get home, especially the engineers. You're burning some of them out, just delaying their length of span of their service. So, sorry, y'all, but it's real life experience, right?
Thank you.
If I could just respond to a couple things on there, and right on. Thank you, Jessica, for those comments and that. We have thought about very seriously about how we can make things easier for the retention of mariner licenses. We recognize that is a big challenge, particularly. And we're having a broader discussion with that, including with the Coast Guard, who is the regulatory body and issuing on the credentials part of that. So today, the Maritime Administration, I think we're the largest provider of reserve training for the Strategic Sealift Officer Program. We bring those folks in. They're on the deck plate on our ships working with our chief engineers. So we do thousands of man days training today for the Navy to be able to support that. It's good for us. It's great for the individuals because they're back on what their initial training was in being a merchant marine officer. And that's a valuable opportunity for that. The idea about how to incentivize retirees or those who got out of the industry to keep their license, we've looked at that, and actually we had the last administration made that request a couple times to Congress to get some money to allowing us to do that, to be able to set up some kind of training programs, or even sponsoring additional billets on U.S. flagships that would be, in my words, they're a MARAD billet, but we're using them as a training base so that people can go out there and sail for, it's not an added cost to the ship owner, I'm paying for it, but then someone's able to keep their credential up, and we have a short string on them if we need them, we can call them back. And the last thing for Navy, Coast Guard, and Army personnel that are departing their services, we've had a great effort with military, Sealift Command, John Thacker helping us, Committee on Marine Transportation System, called Military to Mariner. And the services have made some great progress, the Army, the Coast Guard, the Navy, to be able to take departing members, giving them the certification so that they can walk into the National Maritime Center and be able to get a mariner credential. And so it's some good ideas.
And I would add that Mr. Chuck Nygaard, sitting right here in the second row, has been instrumental in that effort from industry. So mm-hmm. thanks for that, mm-hmm. Chuck. Mm-hmm. John Kaskin?
As the old Scott DiLisio, I have a question for Kevin and the Admiral. I'm an old Cold Warrior, as some folks in the audience, and although General McDew mentioned that it's been 70 years since we worried about contested waters for Sealift, When I was in the Pentagon, we did studies, the Center for Naval Analyses did studies on attrition going across the Atlantic against the Soviet threat at the time. Even with escorts, it wasn't a pretty picture, but at least it certainly was a lot better than it is without escorts. And you know, the Navy has zero frigates today. Our allies, they were going to contribute to support that those convoy operations with escorts. They don't have large fleets anymore. So how were we addressing the movement of our forces back then in the Cold War? Well, the first part of the solution was having 10 divisions in 10 days in Europe, 4 that were stationed there, and 6 had their hardware already in warehouses. And all we had to do was fly the forces across the ocean. The second part of it is that was NATO was going to be providing a list of 600 ships, 400 of which they would be making available for their reinforcing Sealift. This is before we had to build up our LMSRs and fast Sealift ships and all the rest of it. It was a NATO program to provide the Sealift because even back then, our requirement was like 10 ships in 10 days. And that was what the Ready Reserve Force was originally established. Mm-hmm. So if we're gonna go back to the Cold War of mentality, now what, and attrition is a real possibility. Has there been discussions and going back to reopening some of these old mechanisms on how we were actually going to address that threat, which was not to try to steam through it?
Mm-hmm. Is that one mine?
Well, if I could just at least address a little bit on the NATO side, you're right. Today, the mantra within NATO is that each nation deploys themselves. And so the dilemma that I see as the guy across the Atlantic is they're all competing against the same marketplace. They have no assured access. And so when I go there, I talk about you need to have contingency contracts like we have in Visa. You need to have assured access to Sealift. They don't even like the word assured access. And so I'm struggling with them to try to get to those points about how they can have those kind of instruments. Because you're right, the number of ships today that NATO pledges to, it's about, well, I shouldn't say zero. There's one project and they've got 5 ships that are under some kind of a string to be able to pull that. So it is a challenge. So when we look at going back and re-looking at how we would do Sealift, it's trying to take some of the lessons learned I think that we have today to be able to try to do that. But you got to remember, these are NATO partners. They really don't have a fleet out there of their own flagships, very little. And so their control part of it, they don't have that.
So that you're saying that's not one of the solutions is resurrecting the NATO Sealift list since they don't have the resources either. What are the options for protection? I think quick reading of the various force structure analysis, the 350 ship Navy was structured not to provide any escorts across the Atlantic Ocean. It was focused on other areas. I think it was the old 600 ship Navy that was large enough to be able to provide escorts as well as fighting in other scenarios. So Admiral, have people coming up with any ideas on how we're going to address the potential aspects of attrition, or is it still an area where people are just thinking about it and not yet come up with solutions?
Well, I would say that we're in the nascent stage, is what I would call it, at least what my exposure to it has been so far. You know, just this past weekend, I read the 1987 CNA study that you're referring to. You know, and it was written in 1987, and it was set in 1990. And it looked at, you know, sort of a scenario set in Europe that you're talking about where, and this is just after the wall fell, it's a secret document, or else I could, you know, cover it here. But the gist of it was, you know, if we had to take an awful lot of movement, move a lot of ships over to Europe, we had to do it on short order, what would be the possible attrition based on, you know, certain sets of conditions like how wide the slots are or how much convoy we provide and so forth. And I agree with you, you know, it's a pretty staggering, it would be a challenge back then. And that was 1987 with Soviet era. With the submarines of that day using torpedoes only. So you fast forward now to where we are today with modern weaponry, and it would, I believe, that the Battle of the Atlantic II would be extremely challenging. And there are studies that are going on, there are CONOPS types of planning that we're looking at. Fleet Forces has, for example, has formed a team and is looking at that in coordination with CNA. I was talking to, you know, just shooting notes back and forth with Mark Geis over the weekend, and he said that, you know, that they've now are looking at updating that particular study I'm talking about. So I think the answer is, well, I know that the answer is yes, but I say nascent only because, you know, we don't have anything, you know, as mature as the study that I saw, you know, from 87, but there's a clear desire to want to do a review of that based upon modern threats and also the loads on the ships. You know, it's probably not lost on anyone in this audience that when you take a ro-ro or two ro-ros that I have, like a Bob Hope class ro-ro, two of them will carry a brigade combat team. And so when you're talking about losing one ship, you know, in today's environment, that's an enormous amount of combat power. The loss of, you know, one ship and one soul is way too many. I would never dispute that fact. But nowadays, you know, I would think that the loss of a ship we're talking about that has an enormous capability is something that, you know, that has everyone's attention, including General Matthews. And you saw it, you heard it today at lunch, right? He used attrition, I didn't count, I think maybe it was three or four times, right? And when and this is in private conversation, we chuckled. He says he thinks he's the first transcom commander that's ever used that word. And it may be so, you know, that is that the reality on his watch is that to prepare for the future means you must think about attrition. And I'm reminded in, you know, I have this wonderful picture of all the symbology taken on the 3rd of March in 2003. And it's a picture of, we call it the COP, the Commandant Operating Picture. There's 167 ships that are OPCON to MSC on that day. And I keep that graphic as a reminder, am I ready? You know, am I ready to assume OPCON of 167 ships? But I can tell you, you know, in my discussions with all the partners, people are very proud of what they did in 2003, as am I, as an American, of what we can do in 2003. But I will tell you, that's not the contested environment I'm talking about, right, or we're talking about today. You know, sure, the battlefield was contested, but not the seas on which those ships travel. So there is, I know there are a lot of work being done to analyze the problem and to come up with innovative solutions like Scott was talking about with tactics, techniques, procedures, hardware solutions if that's needed. And then the software solutions, that is within the training of the mariners themselves to give them the skills that they need in order to you know, meet that challenge head on.
Well, thank you very much, and I'm glad somebody's read that study that I helped sponsor a long time ago.
let me give you one more, just so the new John Kaskin can walk through something. The assumption that going back, you don't want to relive history or make mistakes you've already learned through. I would submit to you that if you think that the war is a single-dimensional kinetic event, that's where you should think differently. The war is a multidimensional event that has almost nothing to do with kinetic exchange, if you even know when it started. There are some people that think it started already. And so what I would suggest to you is that not everything about the next war is going to be brute force or landing a brigade. It might be out-thinking, out-foxing, and out-tacticking your enemy on one or many planes. So the studies we're conducting today are complex. Some of them have to do with Sealift. Some of them have to do with space. I don't want to go into a lot of detail, but all I would tell you is if you believe that your Navy is sitting on its haunches doing nothing and waiting to be told how to do this, I assure you this is being looked at very carefully. And the next war is not, the next war is brutal compared to anything anybody in this room has experienced. It's brutal in both directions.
Probably got time for one more. Captain Nygaard?
Yeah, hey. Thanks for the shout out about the M2M. I just wanted to give a quick sort of update on what's going on. And there has been some neat progress. But for us, for me, I was fortunate enough to be given the leeway to sort of pursue this because when I started working at Crowley, there was a requirement to hire some captains and some officers, and then it heard, well, we couldn't hire from the Navy because nobody has the quals. I mean, sort of nobody lives that. Everybody lives that. But But the point is, now it's kind of come full circle with us because at Crowley we're trying to hire, and we can't because of the lack of credentials. So we are just sort of doing this just to find the hires. Now, having said that, the National Defense Authorization Act came out, and some of the wording that came out of it came from a listening session, two listening sessions last year with Congressman Hunter and Congressman Garamondi that led that and helped that, and then Senator Blumenthal got involved. And so the wording now says that 180 days, within 180 days of the National Defense Authorization Act signing, that the Navy will report out, that the Navy and Coast Guard will report out to Congress and the Senate Armed Services Committee on progress and way ahead for credentialing, which is good news, except that right now, I don't think the Navy's ready for what's probably going to happen if they come out and say, okay, Navy cool website is the answer, and it's not. And so that's one of the things. So what we're dealing with here is the National Maritime Center, or how much do they validate and bless on what veterans have experienced, and how much does the Navy flex and change their schools so there are dual qualifications. That's the kind of hard stuff that's got to get worked out. But the STAR Center down in Dania has made some really good progress. So there's a lot of things happening in the right direction, but keeping an eye on the 180 days will get interesting. And I guess, you know, one of us will write an article to kind of update everybody on what really happens. But anyway, thank you.
Thank you, Chuck. And unfortunately, that brings us to the end of our discussion. I want to thank the panel again very much. I'd like to thank the Navy League. I'd like to thank LMI for sponsoring it. And thank you all for your loyalty check for being here late on an afternoon prior to the reception. Thank you all very much.